Good morning, all esteemed faculty, keynote speakers, delegates, and organizing team. I'm grateful to the ISR for giving me this opportunity. My special thanks to Dr. Ranjit Singh and his wonderful team for arranging and organizing such a great event in this 8th International Conference of Forensic Medicine. Already there are a couple of presentations which were wonderful, and we know V.V. Pillai sir and Mukesh Yadav sir, who has thrown the light on very, very important topic related to poisoning and medical law and ethics. One more area which we would also interested, and that is very, very important for all of us, is medical certification of cause of death. So in looking into the paucity of time, I will try to focus on practical aspect of this topic, which is medical certification of cause of death. As we all know that death is one thing which is inevitable. The truth of life is death. We all know this. So keeping that in mind, that how we can get information from the death which can be utilized for the betterment of life. So my objective for this session will be that we'll try to understand what is this concept of medical certificate cause of death. We'll also describe its various components in brief, how to prepare MCCD, and we'll discuss about the intricacies, which is the key area which we have kept as a title for this topic, issues and challenges. So keeping these objectives in mind, let me introduce the topic. We all know that all humans are mortal and death is inevitable. We all know this. Medical certificate of cause of death is a permanent record of facts of death. And that's why it is important for us to understand that certification of death and recording of death, both are play a very important role in medical field. So we all know that every birth and death has to be registered, and this act has been passed in 1969. The initiative started in 1964 and ultimately it was passed in 1969. So as per this act, each birth and each death has to be registered, because we have to be aware, the country has to be aware of that there are how many people we are. Now we may be the 130 crores, maybe 140 crores. So this census come based on the registration of birth and death. It is mandatory for a medical practitioner, registered medical practitioner, to prepare a cause of death certificates. And to prepare a cause of death certificate, the commonly forms which are available, and most of practitioner might have seen these forms. One is Form 4, which is for the institutional death, and another is Form 4A, which is for the non-institutional death. After completing this medical certificate of cause of death, this has to be sent to the chief registrar of the birth and death by 10th of each month. So ideally, it is suggested that the completion of the certificate, completion of the death certificate, has to be completed maximum in 21 days after the death of the person. And it has to be sent by 10th of each month to the registrar. The one cannot charge fees for issuing certificate about cause of death. This is very important. There are certain private practitioners, there are certain people who might be charging the fees for issuing death certificates. But if we are aware of that, this is the legal right of the patient's relative, deceased relatives, then probably we would be more wiser. As sir has recently talked about the medical law and ethics and ethical issues, so just keep in mind that this also may lead to some legal and ethical issues, especially for those who may be charging the fees for issuing cause of death certificate. So has the legal, administrative, and statistical values. With these introduction in mind, let's understand what is the importance of this topic. If the cause of death certificate has been filled up as per the guideline which is prescribed, and then it has providing the data for mortality statistics, that these many people are has already died and these people are living. So people, the government may come to know that which people might be getting the benefit like pensions, what is our current population, how we need to channelize our resources based upon the people who are in what age group. This has great role in surveillance of disease. If there are patients which are coming from a particular disease and dying and issuing the cause of death certificate, then you get to know that whether this is of endemic, epidemic or pandemic in nature. So it, accordingly, it can be traced and treated. Evaluation of the disease control program. So evaluation can be done according to the whether based on the surveillance. Based on the evaluation, one can identify outbreak and planning for the corrective measures. If something, how it has to be prevented. Recently, it has been done with the COVID-19. So this has been done. You may be aware of that there are certain articles which has mentioned that the deaths which have occurred because of COVID-19 are projected quite less in comparison. So there are reasons behind it and how the cause of death certificate has been prepared. Now the audit is going on all over the country and they are trying to see whether the death has direct relationship with the COVID-19 or some other comorbid condition or other conditions which are actually responsible for the death of person. So this is just to, why this audit is going on, because there are MCCD document which is available. If this would not have been available, then probably it would be difficult to know that what actually went wrong, by which the several people has died during this second wave of COVID-19. So that's why this MCCD has great importance. It's a permanent record of death. So death is the truth, but the MCCD is the permanent record of death. It looks like this. Many who are the practitioners and forensic science specialists, at some point of time, you might have seen that what is this cause of death certificate? It is called medical certificate of cause of death. This look like this. Let's discuss its component one by one. If you look at the guidelines which is prescribed by the government, the name of disease which has to be mentioned in the certificate, it is to be given in the full. We should not use initial. So just writing down only Sanjay, you can write down the Sanjay Kedarlal Gupta in that way. So if the disease is an infant not yet named, then you can write down that the baby of, daughter of, or son of, so and so, followed by the name of mother. So first will be the name of mother and followed by the father. So in that way it can be named. Age of the person has to be mentioned in completed years. If the person is adult or maybe at the elderly age person died. If the disease was over 1 year, then the give age in completed year. If the disease was below 1 year of age, then the age has to be given in the months. The child was of 6 months, 8 months, completed months. But if the child was or infant was below 1 month of age, then you need to mention the completed number of days. Okay. And if the infant or fetus infant was below 1 day, then you have to mention in hours, maybe 4 hours, 6 hours. So this is the criteria which is given for the age. Just keep in mind, this is very important. Sometimes we don't write it down. I have seen certain certificates where age is just vaguely mentioned or not mentioned at all. So we need to keep in mind that this is the guideline which is given, and accordingly we need to fill up this medical certificate of cause of death. Attending physician must complete this part of the form personally rather than handing over it to the intern or maybe to the resident or somebody else. It is better that it has to be completed by the physician who has attended the patient in last 7 days. The certificate of cause of death is divided into two parts. You must have seen this form 4 and 4A. The difference is not in the content, just that form 4 is for institutional death and 4A is for the non-institutional debt. Rest of things remain same. There are two parts, part one and part two. Part one, if you see, that mention A, B, and C. So if in the part one, you need to mention about the immediate condition, which is responsible for the death. And this immediate condition has to be followed by the antecedent conditions, which are ultimately lead to the final event. And this final event ultimately lead to the death of the person. So in that way, it has to be filled up in part one. So nothing more needed to be written as in the part, in the rest of the part one and part two. Suppose person has died because of ischemic heart disease, NOVA, pneumonia, then it is sufficient to cause to mention. If there is nothing beyond it to be written, then it's absolutely fine. You can just write down that the person has died because of ischemic heart disease or died due to NOVA pneumonia. Often, however, a number of morbid conditions might be present at the time of death. So these all contributing condition or comorbid condition has to be in the part two, and that should be entered after part one. Part one, which is actually responsible for the death, and where we need to mention about the cause of death, not about the mode of dying. Mode of dying may be the heart failure, respiratory failure. So these terms should not be appear in the cause of death certificates. We are not talking about the modes of death. Modes of dying should not be in the, should not be the part of this MCCD. We need to focus only on the cause of death. And cause of death, again, we need to look that the immediate cause of death, which was the final event. And this final event was because of certain other conditions, which could be fall in category of antecedent causes. And these antecedent causes may have some role from the contributing condition or comorbid condition. Right? That is the part two. Morbid condition or injuries may be present, but they are not directly related to the chain of event which causing death, but may contribute some indirect way ultimately for this fatal outcome. So that those kind of conditions which are not directly linked, but indirectly linked, may be incorporated into the part two of this MCCD. The form which I have shown you in the beginning, you must have seen the part one and part two. So part two, which are not directly related. So don't write two or more conditions on a single line. So always try to mention one after another. We can add the points, and the condition which we are mentioning, it has to be written in the legible handwriting. If you are providing the computerized MCCD, then it's absolutely fine. Where also it is advisable that if it is better to be in the capital letter. If you are filling this MCCD by handwritten, then it is always advisable that it has to be legible. If there are issues about the legibility, it can be written in the capital fonts. Maternal death, part one, part two. And below that, you must have seen that there is a column of related to the maternal death. And if be sure to the answer this question that death has occurred because of the pregnancy or delivery, then you need to mention about the age of childbearing woman, and also mention that this has directly or indirectly contributed to the cause of death or not. If this is not linked anywhere to the cause of death, you can say nothing particular or not applicable. Also keep in mind that sometimes it happens that the people died at home who are elderly, crossing the age somewhere, maybe 80 plus, 90 plus, all of a sudden someone found them dead. So old age is also can be given as a cause of death, but try to be more specific as and when possible. If you won't find anything, if the family physician won't find anything which is specific to be written, like ischemic heart disease or maybe pneumonia or maybe some respiratory or cardiac or neuro condition, then you can say that old age could be written, but try to avoid it writing oftenly and frequently. Now the complete case history is not wanted here, but if the information are available, enough details should be given to enable the underlying cause to be properly classified. So if sometimes this is the concept specifically to get the more and more details so that you can reach to the final conclusion that what will be the final event contributing to the cause of death. Example is anemia. Suppose if you are aware of that the person has died because of anemia or its complication, then try to explore, probe further. If you get the more detail about the type of anemia or some neoplasm or carcinoma, which either benign or malignant, so it is better to be more precise, more specific, rather than just writing down that anemia, rather than you can say that it is something which is very specific. In the neoplasm also, you can mention whether it is benign or malignant. And if you are aware of that, say which type of neoplasm, you can directly write down into the cause of death. So rather than be broad and vague, it is better to be precise and specific. In heart disease also, if we can able to identify that whether it is ischemic heart disease, myocardial infarction, core pulmonale, or other conditions, then accordingly we can mention it. Then try to identify that if it is myocardial infection, that what could be the incident condition. Myocardial infections, the incident condition may be the coronary artery disease, may be the atherosclerosis. So ultimately this atherosclerosis lead to the blockage of coronary artery, which ultimately lead to the myocardial, acute myocardial infarction. So in that way you can categorize. Rather than starting from the final outcome, you try to explore that how this event or chain has initiated. Because atherosclerosis, there was coronary artery blockage and that lead to MI. Rather than you go like myocardial infarction is due to the coronary artery disease and that due to the atherosclerosis, so you may go retrospectively also. So these are the some example which I have quoted. Mention the complication of pregnancy and delivery specifically, whether it is pregnancy, this is preeclampsia, eclampsia, some other conditions, hypertensive condition, hemorrhagic condition, any other disorder which is directly responsible for the cause of death. Manner of death, if you must have seen this pro forma, where there is one thing which is mentioned, manner of death. Mostly this MCCD is completed in natural death. If it is suicidal, accidental, homicidal, the one has to follow the legal guidelines prevailing. In accidental and suicidal, private hospitals, they have the different policy. They may ask for postmortem examination, may not be. Police may waive off the requirement of postmortem examination. Those who are working with the institutions which are government, semi-government, or granting aid, where you need to inform the all cases which are unnatural, whether suicidal, accidental, or homicidal to the police, where might be the cause of death may be given after autopsy examination. So the autopsy surgeon has to complete the cause of death certificate after completing autopsy. So if the cause of death is known, then it's easy. But if it is not known, then what is the reason behind this accident, suicide, or homicide? You are not sure. Suppose one example of head injury. Now this head injury may be accidental also, may be suicidal also, or maybe homicidal also. So if you are not sure, let the law enforcement agencies to investigate the matter. So you can mention the pending investigation if you are not sure about the manner of death. There are some examples for better understanding of this concept, medical certificate of cause of death, how to fill it. Now you can see that there are some examples. Part one, you can mention that immediate cause is peritonitis. This peritonitis has occurred due to perforation of duodenum. This perforation of duodenum has occurred because of the rupture or perforation of duodenal ulcer. So actually the patient presented with the duodenal ulcer. This duodenal ulcer get perforated, which lead to the peritonitis, and this peritonitis is ultimately lead to the death of the person. Now the another contributing condition might be the carcinoma of the bronchus, but it is not directly related to the cause of death. But carcinoma bronchus might have some pressure effect on the duodenum. Okay, so that could be the may not be directly related, but maybe indirectly related to the cause of death. Another example is like acute exacerbation of chronic pancreatitis, which is immediate cause, and that has occurred due to the chronic pancreatitis. And this chronic pancreatitis has occurred because the person was chronic alcoholic. So ultimately, when you elaborate and try to explore the history, you get to know that the person was consuming the alcohol on routine basis. And because routine basis made him chronic alcoholic, this has created the complications like chronic pancreatitis. And because of chronic pancreatitis, there is acute exacerbations which ultimately responsible for the death of the person. And the contributing condition in this case could be the diabetes mellitus if the person is having. This is one example where the diabetes mellitus is in the part 2. Another common example which we face routinely, that is acute myocardial infarction. Acute myocardial infarction has occurred due to atherosclerotic heart disease, which actually happened because of the hyperlipidemia. So this non-communicable diseases may have played a great role in ultimately end up with some acute event. So person died because of acute MI, but acute MI actually originated from the hyperlipidemia. So hyperlipidemia lead to the atherosclerosis that lead to the blockage of the coronaries, and ultimately there is infarct. Here person might be having the hypertension, that can be mentioned into part 2. Having diabetes, that also can be mentioned into part 2. If not having, you need not to mention anything. One more example, especially for the this gynecology, the final cause might be the hemorrhagic shock. Hemorrhagic shock occurred because of the disseminated intravascular coagulopathy, which we tell in brief is DIC. And this DIC has occurred because of abruptio placenta. So the female pregnant lady might be having abruptio placenta that may further complicate it, and that lead to DIC, disseminated intravascular coagulation. And this DIC may be responsible for the either septicemic shock or maybe hemorrhagic shock. So the part 2 can be the gestational hypertension. Gestational hypertension means during the pregnancy, she was having the high blood pressure. So that could be the contributing factor, but may not directly related to the cause of death. Similarly, for the orthopedics, like the patient came with the fractured neck femur, but this fractured neck femur may lead to some fat embolism, may lead to bronchopneumonia, which is the immediate cause. Okay. The immediate cause could be the bronchopneumonia, could be the fat embolism, which may occur due to the fracture of neck femur, and person might be having the hypertension or essential hypertension. That can be the part of part 2 of the MCCD. I hope in the different branches, I have tried to get the example from the different branches so that it bring the more clarity how to fill up the medical certificate of cause of death. Other example is gangrene foot. In this case, the diabetes mellitus is directly related and directly causing this gangrene foot. And gangrene foot complications lead to the death. So immediate cause will be maybe the complication of gangrene foot. And gangrene foot has occurred because of the uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. So in that way, this medical certificate of cause of death has to be completed. I hope you are clear to this point of time. We have discussed that why this is required, what is the importance of MCCD, We have discussed the different component of MCCD, like initial preliminary data, how to fill about the name of the person, age of the person, what should be come in part one of MCCD, part two of MCCD. We talked about the some other important thing like maternal or pregnancy related death or manner of death, or if you are not certain about clear about the manner of death, it can be mentioned as pending investigation. We have tried to quoted the example from medicine, surgery, gynec, orthopedics to better understand, to build up the better understanding, so that it help you in easy to understand better how to fill up or complete this MCCD. Routinely, the students of forensic medicine who are the potential IMG, Indian medical graduates, we teach this topic to them, and it is very important for all of us, whether we are forensic specialist or registered medical practitioner, or to understand these components. Now also look at that, what are the challenges or intricacies in this MCCD. In medical legal case, if death occurred, then the police will decide whether there is a need of postmortem examination or not. If the patient was admitted for a longer period of time and the treating doctor is certain about the cause of death, then MSC certificate can be filled up. If police feel that there is no need of postmortem examination, police has provision under section 174 of CRPC to waive off need of postmortem examination. But if the doctor is not sure, then you should not write down anything into the MCCD, just mention about the pending for investigation and let the police to decide about the postmortem examination. The autopsy surgeon who is completing or who is conducting the autopsy, after completion of autopsy, can write down, can fill up this MCCD. At certain states, there are pro forma which may be different than the MCCD. So there are possibility, there is no uniformity. This is one of the important challenge as of now. So we can together work out some mechanism by which we can bring some uniformity in filling MCCD even for the postmortem examination in medico-legal cases. Brought dead, the attending doctor may not be sure. But if the patient is regularly taking the treatment from the same hospital, from the same doctor, and the doctor has reason to believe that there is no foul play in this case, and based on the case history, patient record, treatment record, if doctor is in position to give certificate, MCCD, then it's absolutely fine. But if doctor has reason to believe that he is not in position to give cause of death certificate at this point of time and suspect some foul play, then this can be labeled as a medical legal case, and again the MCCD or cause of death certificate will be given by the doctor who has conducted autopsy. So this is the guideline which we have to follow in broad death cases. If cause of death is not known, patient might be with the doctor for a couple of hours, maybe 10-20 hours, but not certain. May have done some investigation, but still doctor is not in, attending doctor is not in position to give cause of death. Then also the doctor can demand in non-MSC cases about the pathological postmortem, or in MSC cases about the medico-legal postmortem. And accordingly, the cause of death can be given later on. Unnatural death, as I have mentioned earlier also, that in the private, they are not, we can say, it is not their responsibility to great extent to inform cases which are accidental or suicidal. So they can take a call whether they suspect some foul play or not suspecting some foul play. But those who are working in the institutional, which are government, semi-government, grant in aid, or big, some charitable hospital or big hospital, college attached hospitals, it is advisable to inform the police. Better situation would be that in all unnatural death where doctor is not certain, it is police or legal system should be bring into the picture. So that is one thing. And after that, it can be decided whether there is a need of postmortem is required or not. Suppose it's a case of burns. A female patient having 70-80% burns, and she died because of the complication which are arise due to the burns. And treating doctor is very much in position of giving MCCD. Then, though it's a MLC case, but still the certificate can be issued. On table death. So if the person died due to on table death, then who will certify the cause of death? Whether anesthesiologist or surgeon or anybody else or forensic medicine experts, what is to be done? These are the challenges. So again, the on table death also has to be informed to the on table death also has to be first bring it to the notice of the relatives that what they want some interference from the police. Ideally, we have to register such cases MLC, better to be on the safer side. And if it is possible, most of time, whether anesthetics or surgeon may not be in position to give the cause of death certificate, especially when the patient died on table. If that is the situation, then it is always advisable that we can go for the postmortem examination. We can advise, we can label such cases as MLC and do the needful accordingly. So these are the challenges, but still there are some gray areas in the on table death. Sometimes the death may not be declared in the OT. Sometimes the patient is taken to the emergency or ICU again, then death is declared, so and so. So those are the challenges, but again, one has to apply the practical approaches over and above the ideal approaches. Charging fees, as I have mentioned earlier, not to be charged. Multiple department involved, then who will take the responsibility? Then there is a lot of integrity and conflict and confusion. So the department who is leading or the person who has first attended the patient or attended within 7 days, or the primary department, the patient might be having some ischemic heart disease, but at the same time, person may fall down and may have some fracture also. So in that case, the medicine department will be responsible over and above the orthopedic department. So primary department who has taken up the responsibility, though there are multiple references, multiple department involved, but still the responsibility will be on the primarily and the first attending department. Sometimes it happens that the person may die at home and not come to the hospital. Then who will issue the cause of death certificate? And especially in the some rural and tribal areas, they do even the rituals, their rituals, whether it is, we can say the burial of the body or whether it is some funeral of the body. So they do their rituals. So after that, you may be aware of that there is a coding system which is going on, which is based on the verbal autopsy. They try to explore, probe that what happened lastly, who has seen the deceased, what was his condition day before, even prior what happening, and based on which they prepare a scenario, and based on that scenario the cause of death is given. And this is the concept of verbal autopsy, which is also going on. Even we have in India, we have this system also, which is there are people who are known as coder, and they get some we can say the very minor remuneration for that also. So these are the challenges, these are the intricacies with MCCD. So we have tried to address that this is medical certificate of cause of death is such thing which is very vital and very crucial for all of us. We need to understand that how ideally it has to be completed. We also need to understand the practical aspect of this medical certificate of cause of death, how to fill it, what are the possible intricacies or challenges which we may foresee. So the challenges which I have mentioned mostly based upon the practical experience, and still there could be the many other challenges which those who are actually dealing with the completion of MCCD may be facing the multiple challenges which we can discuss at some point of time. But as I have mentioned, that sometimes you need to choose the practical approach over and above the ideal approach. So that is something which we need to take a call. We can choose the practical approach, but keeping in mind that what is ideal. If we are aware of the guidelines, if we are aware of the legalities, if we are aware of the ethical issues, then definitely, even though we are adopting the practical approach, but that practical approach will keep in mind those legal and ethical and other issues in mind. So with this, with this last quote, I would like to end my presentation. I have tried to keep it crisp and short, and try to give you just the salient points about the MCCD, which are important for all of us. So there may be no single thing that can teach us more than about life than death. So we know that the person who is living may be mimicked in different way. And we all, in the forensic science, there is a thing that dead bodies speak everything. We need ears to listen. We need eyes to see. Okay. So with this, I end my presentation. Once again, I'm thankful to the whole wonderful team of IASR. Specific thanks to Dr. Ranjit Singh for giving me this opportunity, for sharing my views and thoughts about MCCD. And I would say that learning is a continuous process. Even I am learning. I will try to address some of a specific question, but as B.B. Pillai sir also mentioned, that I am not the encyclopedia of everything. So with this, thank you very much.